Hi divers, Alec, Peirce from Vintage Scuba. I'm sorry I'm talking fast. Kevin says I have to keep these videos shorter. They're getting too long. So blame Kevin if I talk too fast and keep them short. This is a Fuji Marine case. Fuji, that's what it's called. Fuji Marine 8. These are pretty popular, you know, and they came in a couple of different versions. I have one as well that has wings on it. Wing out each side, yellow wing for stability. I don't know how it worked in currents, but it kept you from bobbling around. But this actually was actually pretty neat, because if you happen to be lucky enough, rich enough, I suppose, to be able to afford to take movies, it was a big deal at one time, then you probably had a Fuji camera. You take movies of the kids. Yeah. Oh, here's my kids eating at McDonald's. And so on, you see. And you buy the cartridges and put them in, and then you would take a movie. But if you were a diver and you had a Fuji 8mm movie camera, you could buy one of these Fuji Marine cases from Fuji. Nobody else really made them. And put this back together somehow. And then the back goes onto it like that and locks in place. And of course, you couldn't use the viewfinder on the camera. You had to use these sort of like Canon scopes, you know. And I'm like, okay, pretty close. Okay, smile, kids. And you got an 8mm underwater film. Yeah, pretty neat. No, it wasn't used on Sea Hunt, but it's a kind of a neat piece. And this is Vintage Scuba. I think this is pre-75. I have to double check on that, but I know it's not new by any stretch of the imagination. But that's an example of a very early recreational diver movie cameras. Okay, hey, I'm back. Okay, let me show you a couple more that are kind of interesting. First of all, let's deal with this one, because this was a production camera. I mean, it was made. You can go to the store and buy this. If you had lots of money, these were probably $60, $70 for an underwater camera housing and camera. But this was actually a camera. This was not really a housing. There's a difference. A camera you take on the water and take pictures. A housing, you put your camera inside the housing and seal it. Then you jump in the water and go and take pictures. So you see the difference? This is actually a camera. Exactly. It's a black box. Okay, and you took the lid off, four big wing screws, which you took the lid off, and then there's a reel inside, and you took your film and spread it. I think it was 110 film, probably 110. You put the film in, and you cranked a little bit, and it stopped. Okay, and you put a bulb, remember bulbs, flash bulbs? Maybe some of you do. The blue dot, Sylvania blue dot flash bulb, yeah. Like this, and you got the wire hooked up, and you're all set to go, and the shutter's down here. And again, this used like Canon sights again. So the bullseye on the front, you see, and a little knob back here, and you would line the knob up with that, and you name it the fish like that. And if it was 10 feet away, you'd aim a little bit higher, and so on. And you're all ready to go. Snap. Whoop. When I snapped there, Kevin, the shutter opened, I could see a little blink of light in there. It's a camera. This is actually a box. It's a camera. There's no camera in there. This is the camera. Pretty neat. Now, I want to show you something else that's really neat about this camera. The Aqua-Cam. Okay, remember that. You see right here, I don't know if you can see that there, Kevin. You don't need to zoom in. But that, you see that right there? It's got a little metal cap. Huh, that comes off. That's pretty neat. Oh, look. That's a Schrader valve. Schrader valve. You know what a Schrader valve is? You got one in your bicycle tire. You got one in your car tire. Look down inside the valve stem. That little thing you press on it, air comes out. And, you know, it seals the air inside. What do they have a Schrader valve in a camera housing for? It was actually pretty common in commercial cameras and in homemade cameras too. We would often install a Schrader valve. Why? Well, because the O-rings weren't very good. In fact, some didn't have O-rings. I have not had those open. I'm not sure. This could be a flat piece of rubber. And you squeeze these down really tightly, and you hope that you squeeze tightly enough that it would seal. But to help, what you could do then is you would go to your corner gas station on the way to the dive site, right? And you get the hose, and not very much. Now go easy here. You only need about 10-15 psi tops, and you'd put some air inside the camera, right? Yeah, you understand why? That would help to keep the rubber seal in place. There's a bit of pressure on the inside of the camera. The camera didn't care. Camera's made of cast aluminum. The camera didn't care. It was pretty strong. Now, don't put in too much, because you could blow the seal out too, too much pressure inside. But look, I guess if you're going on a deep dive, you put in more. I'm not too sure. I haven't read the instructions on that, but that's a pretty neat old camera with bullseye, the viewfinder, and a Schrader valve pressure. Okay, two more cameras and housings I want to show you. This one is homemade. I know it's homemade because the gluing is not very good. If you were able to look closely at this, how come you didn't dust this one off, Kevin? You always dust off my stuff. This one you did, but you can see that this is homemade. Okay, the guy's got some great ideas. He may have used Mark Togweiler's book, How to Make Your Own Underwater Housing. It's a great little book that I have a copy, a couple of them maybe, and it came out in the 60s, I believe. A chap by the name of Mark Togweiler, and he produced this book on how to make a housing. And you go and you buy plastic, see, plastic, and you glue it together. You get your camera, you measure it, and you glue it together. And there's a camera in here. This is an Instamatic camera. I'm not going to take it out, but it's an Instamatic. It's a, who made Instamatic? Kodak? Instamatic camera, Kodak 154. Whoa, made by Kodak. Yeah, Kodak, right on there. A little snap camera. I think they used a 1/26 film, a little smaller. And you put it on like that, and you took pictures with the camera. Well, this chap has made a housing for his camera, probably using ideas from Mark's book, and he put handles on it. And if you look closer here, you'll see it's kind of neat what he's done. On the inside of the handle, can you see in there? You actually got a lead weight, and he put a screw from the side to hold it there so this camera would be negative, so it's heavy in the water. You don't want your camera housing floating up to the surface. If you let go of it, it's gone. So you want it to be heavy, you just hung on to it. You put a lanyard on, so if it let go, it hung on your hand, but at least it hung there and stayed there. Maybe he has it buoyed just the right amount of weight so that it is exactly neutral and just sits there. Now, this particular camera, I don't see any means for advancing the film, so maybe it's an automatic. Was the Instamatic automatic? Do you remember? No? But anyway, there's a shutter here. Oh yeah, that does that. How does he advance the film on here? I have no idea. There's no control for that. It must have been an automatic, spring-loaded maybe. There's no knob. Don't give me that no knob. There's no knob. There's no knob on the outside for advancing. That must be one of the early automatic types of Instamatics. Pretty neat, huh? And, oh look right here. What's this? He's got glued on right there. Yep. Schrader valve. That's what it is. Gas station. A little bit of air, because the seal in here is just a flat piece of rubber. Yeah. And a couple other things that kind of neat about this. Let me show you this. When I teach my underwater photography classes, when I was teaching a great deal, I said to the people, you want to get a good picture, get close. And if you want to get a really good picture, get closer. And if you want a great picture, get closer still. The point being that you have to be close. I used to tell my students that if you want to get a good picture of any marine subject, you have to be able to touch it. You have to be able to reach up and touch it. Now don't, because if it's a fish, it's gone. But you have to be within 2.5 to 3 feet to get a good picture. I don't care how good the lens is, it doesn't matter. In fact, the wider angle lenses, the closer you should get. But that's the point is, you should get close to shoot. So this gentleman, he played with this and so on, and he learned that. And he took a piece of tape and he wrote, shoot close on it. To remind himself to shoot close, yeah. And his viewfinder was pretty neat. It was just a round tube, so you couldn't be off. The subject had to be inside that round tube. And again, he also has attached to this another neat thing that I've seen before. I haven't seen one for a long time, but I have seen these before. These were production, a little mesh. Well, what's this for, Kevin? In case you catch a fish or a lobster or something?
Yeah,
lobster. No. It has a piece of rubber on top. And so you could reach inside of it and pull out your flash cube. Now the flash is gone. The flash is no longer on this film. But these were these little GE flash cubes. You put them on and you turn them flash. You get four flashes out of the cube. And you could take these underwater. They float. So you could take these underwater. You could put a whole bunch of new good ones down in there. And about 10 of them in there, and off you go, and you could shoot 40 pictures. Well, the film had 12 on it, but anyway. And this bag is what held them in. They floated, so this floated up beside you all the time. And I'd like to think that when he used one up, he put the used one in there and didn't just let it go. It wasn't uncommon in the old days before we got smart about the underwater environment. There you go. Homemade camera for an Instamatic and a flash cube holder. And lastly, a very special housing. Special to me because this was made by a very good friend of mine who unfortunately just a few years ago is gone. He's gone now. But he made this housing. This is actually a camera as well. And it's kind of interesting because this is metal. This gentleman was a machinist. Yes. And so naturally enough, he's a machinist. What does he know? He knows about metal, right? So he built out of metal. So here are six pieces of metal trimmed and cut. And all the seams are silver soldered. Oh yeah, did a nice job. This is kind of neat on here, Kev. You see this? That's just a brace, and he made it look like a dive flag. It's all braced, so it's extra strong on there. And he's got a window in the front, silver solid frame, and viewfinder. One of the controls is on the side here. There's a little knob here for turning. There's an electrical connection at the back, so perhaps he had a flash of some sort to go with it. I don't know too much about this. He gave this to me a long time ago and said, here's an old underwater housing I made for cameras years and years ago. And that's quite true. Just to give you an idea of what we had available in the 50s and the 60s and even into the 70s. It certainly wasn't like today. Sophisticated, where you can take your iPhone down. Now, I understand that new iPhones are waterproof, but you can also get housings, little cheap little housings, and take your iPhone down. You can't get much better pictures than an iPhone or a comparable Android, and take great pictures with anything, anytime now, movies, everything. In the old days, you had to be a little more dedicated. If you wanted to get a good picture underwater, you had to work, and then you get the pictures, and then what do you do? Well, you take them into Benjamin Studios, and you wait for a week for the prints to come back to see if you got anything good. Yeah, a different world. But it was neat, a lot of fun, and part of the history of scuba diving. There you go. Hope you enjoyed that. Alec Peirce, Vintage Scuba. Was that short enough, Kevin?
Yes.
Talk to you soon.